pleasure to assemble this evening to celebrate the inaugural lecture of Professor Khalida Ismail. It's a special pleasure to welcome the family member, especially the young stalwarts who have come, other members of the Ismail family. Welcome to all of you. And welcome to all colleagues and friends of Khalida. I thought as we start this evening, it would be befitting to give you a very short introduction of Khalida. She was born in Huddersfield, was a student at the Greenhead College there, and then actually first decided to study law at Cambridge. And if that wasn't enough, she then decided to study medicine at Oxford. Went on then to get her MRCP and finally her MRC Psych in 1994. And if that wasn't enough in terms of degrees, went on to get an MSc in Epi at the London School of Hygiene. And if that wasn't enough, that's an inspiration, young men, watch. So if that wasn't enough, she then went on to get a PhD at the University of London. But all of that in the service of something very important. She is a liaison psychiatrist and an epidemiologist with a special interest in diabetes and depression. And in fact, many people around the world, when you take the name diabetes and depression together, they often do indeed think about Khalida and her work. And her research has helped in the understanding the epidemiology and the underlying mechanisms of the depression and diabetes link. And I think we shall hear some more about it when she speaks about the mind in diabetes. But it's not just about understanding and basic discovery. What has been very important about her work is that it leads to new innovations, to new treatments, and actually helps patients here and now. So we are very proud that Khalida has actually pursued most of his career here at the Institute of Psychiatry and in our partner King's College Hospital. And as her application was put forth, it was my pleasure as a dean to support it, but I'm also privy, of course, to what the external reviewers say about it. So for those of you who haven't been through this promotions process at King's, to get such a promotion, of course, the candidate has to first get the approval of their head of department, which gave them then an approval from the dean, but then it goes to the college level, and the college sends it out to 6 international referees, people who do not know Khalida, well, they know professionally, but do not have a close professional relationship. So her papers and her work is sent out to 6 international referees, and they anonymously, unbeknownst to her, write to the college their review and opinion of it. And I can tell you, all of them who wrote me commented upon the world-class nature of the research, and these were mostly people from outside of the UK. They were all awed by her ability to get grants to Khalida. They said that in any system, regardless of whether it was the UK or not, it would be very impressive. They were also very impressed with the multidisciplinary nature of the work, because Khalida brings together many disciplines to do what she does. They were very impressed with the large number of postgraduate research students. But most of all, and this is the holy grail for all of us who are clinical academics, they were very impressed by how her basic discoveries and work is actually making a difference for patients here and now and in our local communities. So I think we're all very impressed and proud of her success. And not only have you been successful, but you're now, of course, leading a mentorship program. And indeed, you're an inspiration to all of us. So Khalida, on to your lecture, The Mind and Diabetes, The Final Frontier.
These are the voyages of the Institute of Psychiatry Starship Enterprise. Her research excellence framework returnable mission to explore strange new worlds of type 1 and type 2 diabetes, to seek out new life, diabetologists, diabetes specialist nurses and dietitians, and new civilizations came to diabetes clinics, to boldly go where no psychiatrist has gone before. Why diabetes? Diabetes is a common chronic condition characterized by persistent high blood sugar or hyperglycemia. It is a condition that affects, there's an epidemic of type 2 diabetes. There have been major medical advances in understanding the medical aspects of diabetes and amazing new drugs and technologies to help improve people's glycemic control. Yet despite this, nearly half of patients with diabetes do not achieve optimal glycemic control, and persistent high blood sugars leads to diabetes complications and premature mortality. Yet at the same time, the understanding how the mind affects the causes and consequences of diabetes is barely scraped. I've divided my talk into three sections. I'll first talk about type 2 diabetes, which affects 90% of cases. Type 2 diabetes is a condition that relates to the pancreas not being able to make enough insulin for the body to function properly, and also for the body cells not to be able to use the insulin properly. There's an epidemic of type 2 diabetes, secondary to the epidemic of obesity, and also to the fact that we don't exercise much and are really living longer. I'm going to, it affects people mainly in their 50s and 60s, but the disease has been developing invisibly for many years beforehand. I'm going to show you that the depression and diabetes, that there is more in common than we originally thought. And in fact, there may actually be the same condition, namely inflammation, but that they are presenting in different body symptoms. The second part of my talk is type 1 diabetes, which represents 10% of all cases of diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune condition where there is complete destruction of the beta cells in the pancreas. So the person with diabetes has to take daily insulin to live. It's still not clearly understood what the causes are, but the incidence is slowly increasing, and nearly half of all the cases are diagnosed in early childhood or young adult life. The main focus of my talk here is to show you how we've developed pioneering psychological approaches to help people improve their diabetes self-management. The third aspect of my talk is to show how our research findings have been translated into clinical services. So how is it that a psychiatrist is working in diabetes? I learned medicine at medical school, but I was also suffering from recurrent episodes of depression. So that affected my decision as to whether I became a physician. At the same time, I was naturally drawn to psychiatry because the clinical constructs were very familiar to me. When I joined psychiatry, I learned that I could get better, I received treatment, and I recovered from my depression. I was very lucky and privileged to have an excellent training at the Maudsley Institute of Psychiatry. I was lucky to be trained and supervised and just to be around some of the greatest minds in contemporary psychiatry at the time. And these included David Milberg, Robin Murray, Sam Wesley, Tony David, Julie Leth and Janet Treasure. And I enjoyed psychiatry, but I was increasingly drawn back into medicine and to King's College Hospital. And this is where I went. I went to the diabetes clinic at King's. I was interested in pain. I thought, as a liaison psychiatrist, I needed to really understand pain. So I asked Peter Watkins if I could visit his and observe his peripheral neuropathy clinic. Now, Peter Watkins is one of the greatest diabetologists that I know. William Osler said that a good physician treats the disease, and a great physician treats the patient with the disease. And Peter Watkins falls into that category of great physicians. He allowed me to observe his clinic. And what did I find? This is the diabetes clinic in the 1990s. And yes, it was a can of worms. There were patients there who were in pain, who were depressed, who were disabled with their complications, who were struggling with accepting and managing their diabetes. But at the same time, the perceived wisdom was that we didn't ask about their feelings, because if we did, we wouldn't know what to say to them, and we would be here all day. As I sat observing the clinic, seeing one patient after another, tearful, in pain, suffering from depression that was either detected, but little detected, not adequately treated, I eventually had enough. And I sat offered to Peter Watkins that I could see these patients. And I don't think that offered quickly enough because he quickly sighed with relief, gave me a clinic room straight away, and I haven't left since. But at the same time, time, there were these landmark studies that really should have helped people with diabetes. This is the key landmark study for type 2 diabetes, the UK PDS. On the right-hand side, it shows that intensive treatments where you add insulin leads to improvements in blood glucose control. So that's the lower line in blue. But there are two problems with this. The first is that on the right-hand side, that adding insulin to your treatment meant that you put on weight. And the second problem is that type 2 diabetes is a progressive condition. So no matter how hard you try, your blood glucose will continue to get worse. Around the same time was the DCCT study, which was intensive insulin therapies in type 1 diabetes, where we showed, well, they showed in the States, that people with type 1 diabetes were given intensive treatments. That meant a lot of supervision with a diabetes nurse, doctor, dietitians, and more frequent injections of insulin, did indeed get improved blood glucose control, which is the bottom line on the right-hand side. However, this also led to improvements and reductions in diabetes complications. However, this also came with a problem, that the tighter that your blood glucose, the more that there was the risk of having a severe hypoglycemia or very low blood sugar. So patients with type 1 diabetes, if they wanted to have good control, would be walking on a tightrope. So no wonder that they had psychological issues, some patients. And there have been many different ways that the patient described different things. And Katie Rich, who's one of the medical students now, but was a research worker with me, analysed a whole series of therapy tapes. But here are some of the key themes that come out. Some patients blame everything on diabetes. This is one of my first patients who said, every time the tube breaks down, I blame the diabetes. There are patients who become perfectionists. Every time I get a higher sugar reading, I feel like a failure. There are patients who get fed up and nervous about the constant medical scrutiny and gaze from their friends and family and develop stigma and feel the odd one out. And finally, in my own clinic, I think nearly all of my patients have struggled with coming to accept that they have diabetes. No wonder then that at least 10% of patients with diabetes clinics suffer from clinical depression of the type that you can treat with either antidepressant and or therapy. And if you don't look after your diabetes control, here are some of the complications. On the right-hand side is the back of the normal eye and normal vision. But with diabetic retinopathy and the damage to the eye, this is what happens to their vision, increasingly patchy and then ultimately becoming blind. And this is a picture courtesy of Mike Edmonds. Persistent high blood sugars causes damage to nerve endings, leading to loss of pain sensations. So what happens is that if you might accidentally step on a splinter or a nail, I may not notice this, and this leads to an infection, which you may also not notice, and then eventually you will end up with a disability and amputation. So the problem is that there is an epidemic of diabetes, mainly type 2. Around half of patients with diabetes struggle with self-management in achieving optimal blood glucose control. Persistent high blood sugars lead to complications and premature death. And depression is twice as common in diabetes than in the general population and could be a barrier to self-management. It was at this point that I went on my first maternity leave. And when I came back, Peter Watkins had retired. There was a whole new consultant who I'd never heard of that had turned up called Stephen Thomas. I was in despair. Peter Watkins got it. He understood about the mind in diabetes, and I wasn't so sure about Stephen. I thought he'd be just like another physician, another medic. He'd be really concrete if I told him about, oh, it's this person's childhood experiences, and that's why she's not looking after her diabetes. His eyes would roll. I was so wrong. Stephen Thomas is just such a great owner of a physician as Peter Watkins. He has taught me so much about clinical and academic diabetes, and he has helped me write and rewrite many grant proposals, and when they get rejected, he just laughs. He has a great bird's eye view of the world, but also has an intellect for macroscopic detail, and for which makes him an extraordinary and valued colleague. I'd like to move on to type 2 diabetes. I'd like to focus on why is depression so common in diabetes, and why is that I find in my clinic it was also very difficult to treat. My colleagues in the States have already observed that depression increases the risk of developing type 2 diabetes by about 60%. And the model to explain this, the conventional model, was the psychological model. That is, depression leads to self-neglect, which leads to poor lifestyle, such as overeating, this decreased activity and smoking, and that this then leads to the increased risk of diabetes and poor diabetes control. At this point, we started talking to Mike Edmonds. Mike Edmonds is one of the world's leading physicians in diabetic foot disease. He and his team have won many awards for their work in improving diabetes foot outcomes. And with that case, we have one of the lowest rates for amputation in the country, if not the world. Mike and Peter were looking for some research projects, and I had just finished my master's in epidemiology. And Mike used to say, I remember these words, he used to say, I just don't get it. These ulcers, they take about 12 weeks to heal, and they're taking much longer. I just don't know why that is. I think it's something to do with the pin here, and I'm not sure what it is, and let's go find out. And as a result, we applied for a welcome grant and to study the effects of depression on diabetes outcomes in people who get their first diabetic foot ulcer. At this point, Kirsty Winkley joined me, and I must be doing something right because she's still here with me. After doing health psychology and then nursing, she became my first PhD student, working also full-time on the diabetic project. She's now becoming an independent researcher with her own NIHR postdoctoral fellowship and has a great career ahead of her. She recruited over 250 people with their first diabetic foot ulcer. These are people that, in theory, according to my papers, should get better within 12 weeks. From all the hospital and community foot clinics around South East London, she followed them up for 18 months. We found that even after controlling for age, blood glucose control, diabetes complications, smoking, etc., that depression had a twofold increased risk of mortality, that's the lower line, compared to those who were not suffering from depression. We followed these patients up for a further, those who are still alive, followed them up for a further 5 years with two diabetes physicians, Yada and Dorini, and we found the effect of depression continued to persist 5 years later. We were just beginning to realize how adverse the effects of the mind were on the body in diabetes. If that was the case, that depression is so bad for diabetes, then psychological approaches such as cognitive behavioral therapy, which would help to improve self-management, should have overcome this problem. So Kirsty and I, with Sophia Rabihiska, conducted a systematic review of all the treatment studies that examined the effects of psychological treatments to improve glycemic control, and this was published in The Lancet. We found, not many studies, very small studies, of course, sample sizes, etc., but we found that there was a small effect size of the effects of psychological treatments in improving glycemic control, not big enough to overcome the effect of depression. So it seemed that this depression in diabetes seems to be a little bit difficult to treat. At the same time, we were collaborating with a colleague, Aaron Ewing, in Birmingham, who was synthesizing the studies the other way around. He showed that type 2 diabetes increased the risk of new cases of depression by about 20%. In other words, the association was going both ways, depression causing diabetes and diabetes causing depression. So we are left with a chicken and egg problem, a bit like this cartoon. Here is the egg cowboy walking into a saloon full of chickens and asking who came first. And that was the dilemma that was left for researchers like myself wondering, well, which came first? Our perceived wisdom was it was always depression causing poor self-care leading on to diabetes, but it looks like it could be going both ways. So at this point that I worked to set up a partnership with Stephanie Stephanie Ailing, the R.D. Lawrence Professor of Diabetes here at King's, has been one of the most influential colleagues in my career. She supported my work and helped to build our service, and it is testimony to her that we have one of King's has one of the largest diabetes and mental health services in the UK, if not in the country. I always say that the really best physicians also make excellent psychiatrists. And one of the things about Stephanie's referrals was that she already always made the psychiatric diagnosis for me, cutting my work out. We had a great partnership in applying and being awarded the first NIHR program grant for diabetes. Stephanie is such a great leader, and she commands such huge respect, and it's a credit to her that we managed to get the South London Diabetes Cohort Study off the ground. What is SILD? SILD is a prospective cohort study in primary care to test the effects of depression on biomedical, psychological and social outcomes in new onset type 2 diabetes followed up for 2 years. It is set in Lambeth at the Convolution. We invited all the surgeries in these three boroughs, Lambeth, Southern Convolution in red, blue and yellow respectively, to participate. We wanted to choose and select patients who were representative of the local multi-ethnic and socio-economically diverse sample. And we were able to recruit a record in 100 surgeries. And epidemiologist research like this needs an army. And we had one of the best research teams I've ever worked with. And this is thanks to Kirsty's people skills. She has this ability to attract the best master's graduates and the young doctors to come and work with us. And from which we recruited our PhD student, John-Pierre Lack, and Rosa Stockford. In fact, Rosa Stockford fell in love with the work so much that she's about to start graduate medical school. Now, this is a busy slide, but it's a slide to show you the prevalence of depression in our SILD project. And the key main things that you need to look at are those in orange. We invited all patients, nearly all 2,000 of them, to complete a self-report questionnaire about 9 symptoms of depression. And we found around about 12% of them said that they were depressed according to these symptoms. And then we interviewed a sample of these and using research diagnostic criteria. And we found that now only half of them actually had a depression. And this is actually half of what we would expect from the previous studies, which was 10%. And this was a little bit not quite what we expected. So what we did is that we looked at every single one of the 9 symptoms who were scoring positive on the questionnaire, but not scoring positive, but were not present when we interviewed them. And we found that those 6 of the 9 symptoms remained high, but there were 3 symptoms that remained high when you weren't depressed. And these were fatigue, appetite, and sleep, the ones that do not have the asterisk. It sounds like patients with diabetes who are saying they're depressed but are not actually depressed if you interview them actually have an excess of a number of bodily symptoms of fatigue, appetite, and sleep. We also found in this group that the patients who were depressed were about 5 years younger. and also that they had a higher body mass index, that they were more overweight. But that those who were depressed had no difference in their blood glucose control compared to those who were not depressed. And this didn't quite make sense. If the model was that depression causes poor self-care, then you would have expected a higher blood sugars in this group of patients. Instead, what we had were a group of patients who appeared to be depressed who were biologically more ill. They were younger, they were more overweight, and they also had an excess of some bodily symptoms. Now, the person who came to the rescue to help explain all of this is John Pickup, who is Professor of Diabetes and Metabolism. Before I knew how famous he was, I used to ask my diabetes colleagues, have you ever heard of John Pickup? And they used to laugh at me and say, of course you have. It was a bit like asking a Catholic, have you ever heard of the Pope? He was the author of the world-famous textbook of diabetes. He's a bit like a wonder of the world. He knows everything that there is about diabetes and metabolism. I spent many years learning and listening to him, trying to remember every bit of nugget of information that he has, never quite being able to say it exactly the same way that he did. He gave me insight into understanding metabolism and medicine in a way that I could see could apply to psychiatry. In fact, he was way ahead of me, he was the first person to actually propose that there may be a common biological link between depression and diabetes. In 1997, he proposed that activation of the innate inflammatory response and inflammation was on the causal pathway of type 2 diabetes and its complications, such as cardiovascular disease, depression, and cognitive impairment. And since then, there have been now thousands of studies showing that activation of the innate inflammatory response is associated with the onset of type 2 diabetes. And there is increasingly evidence that this may also be relevant in depression. How could this work then? So actually, the concept is really quite well known. The principle is one of an toxin. So if you have only an infection, this activates your innate inflammatory response, releases pro-inflammatory cytokines from the macrophages, which leads to a release of acute phase blood proteins, such as the C-reactive protein, which incidentally is one of the oldest proteins in evolution. Now that normally is what happens in infection. John Pickett proposed that excess fat was a bit like an infection, was a bit like a toxin that activated the innate inflammatory response. That if you have this excess environmental toxin going on for a long enough time, that this would lead to cell damage and multiple bodily symptoms, such as destruction of the pancreatic beta cells, destruction of the endothelial cells, and of the brain cells. That if this carried on even longer, that this will lead to manifest disease, such as type 2 diabetes, heart disease, depression, and cognitive impairment. There is now evidence that, for instance, that you can even consider psychosocial adversity as a type of environmental toxin, because there's evidence that early childhood experiences of abuse and also of chronic social adversity leads to activation of the innate inflammatory response. So we tested this. Jean-Pierre Lac, our PhD student, examined 11 inflammatory markers in SOD, and we found that 6 of these were raised, even after adjusting 4 relevant confounders. I'm just going to give you some examples of them. First is that the white cell count was raised in people who were depressed compared to those who weren't at the time of diagnosis of type 2 diabetes. So was the C-reactive protein. And so was another inflammatory marker, the interleukin-1 receptor antagonist. So it seems like the John Pickett was right, that there is a common relationship between depression and diabetes, and that this might be inflammation. I'd like to take a pause here and ask and tell you why or how is it that a psychiatrist was able to get away from mainstream psychiatry for so long. And it's thanks to Sarah Wesley, who has been my head of department and my supervisor for more years than I can care to remember. He has helped me and supported me in many ways that I could tell you. But here are some examples. When I was doing my PhD, I did wonder whether he'd ever get around to supervising me, let alone reading my manuscript. But he was there right at the last minute with absolutely perfect insight. And he could see what I was doing with the diabetes and depression work and help develop a business case for my senior lecturer's post in diabetes and psychiatry. And he is the original Athena Swan prototype. When I came back from my second maternity leave, the IOP did not have a sibling policy, and he went about and changed it. Also, when I wasn't around in the department that much with 2 young children, I didn't quite know what to say to him about that. He said, "Listen, Khalida, I don't really mind what you do, where you do it, or how you do it." And that was a godsend for an ambitious working mother like myself, because it gave me the flexibility to do both things as long as I delivered the research excellence framework objectives. In fact, most heads of departments would boast about their income grants and the number of PhD students, but I think Simon Wesley has an additional boast. He must have the largest number of female academics who have not only come back from their first maternity leave, but their second maternity leave. So I would say, get in there quick in psychological medicine, because it's about to go off to become the president of the Royal College of Psychiatrists. criteria to really be a successful clinical academic, at least in psychiatry. And I attribute my work ethic to my family. My parents, they're my parents, unfortunately, I'm a bit lost on the motorway and can't make it here today. My father, who is a village headmaster, used to buy books from auctions, all the Enid Blyton series and all the pairs of encyclopedias, despite how poor we were. And my mother, who's had no education, is one of the most intelligent women I know, and my first experience of a feminist role model. I was the middle of a 5-6 ship, so you can imagine that there was some jostling going on. But I'd like to thank my parents for everything they've given me, and also to my brothers and sisters for all, in their own unique way, of giving me their love and support over the years. Now I'd like to move on to type 1 diabetes. Kirsty and I were on a roll with our systematic reviews, and so we also repeated the systematic review of psychological interventions to improve glycemic control in people with type 1 diabetes, and this was published in the BMJ. And what we found was a sort of similar story. We found that psychological treatments seem to improve diabetes control in young people, but less so in adults. But this just didn't make sense. Because in my clinic, these are the kind of things that I was observing. Patients were telling me that they had all sorts of negative thoughts and feelings about their diabetes, and here are just some examples. What did I eat? Where is my meter? What is my blood sugar? How many carbs in that cookie? Am I going to live? Am I going to die? Can I make it to lunch? All of these thoughts. So we had to set about developing intervention. So with Stephen Thomas, Ulrika Schmidt, Janet Treasure, and Trudy Jordan, we developed a new intervention to help improve people's diabetes control. Let's just mention Janet Treasure, who's been a major influence in the whole of my career. I've been in total awe of what she has achieved and what she can do. She's always one step ahead of all the literature, scanning and scoping. And I remember in our last round that we wrote together, she was still sending me key papers a few hours before submission. And it is because of these papers that we were awarded a grant. What did we do? We conducted a randomized controlled trial, testing motivational interviewing, people with that cognitive behavioral therapy, to improve diabetes control in people with type 1 diabetes compared to usual care. What is motivational interviewing? Janet Treasury is a world-renowned expert on this, as well as on eating disorders. It's different from the normal medical communication style. So I have been sitting in a clinic where patients have been, up to this point, being told this classic medical model, which is if you don't look after your diabetes, you're going to lose your eyes, your kidneys, your feet, and you're going to die early before you're 30. And I even have patients who've been told, and your veins will be deformed. That was the sort of the standard way of talking to patients, and it wasn't working. So the motivation interviewing model is a slightly nicer, well, much nicer way of talking to patients. It's directive, it's patient-centered, and focused, goal-directed style for eliciting behavior change by helping patients to explore and resolve ambivalence towards their diabetes self-management. Motivational interviewing is very effective. It's a brief intervention of only 4 sessions, and experience in the addictions world shows that the effects wear off. So we added sessions of cognitive behavioral therapy for diabetes, where the principle is the way you think and feel affects the decisions you make about your diabetes management. So for instance, I can't get the blood sugars right, I'm a failure, leads to all sorts of feelings around anxiety, guilt, and low mood, and also to decisions about whether to look after their diabetes, such as under or over-checking or overcompensating. What did we find in our randomized controlled trial? We found that people who received usual care, surprise, surprise, there was no improvement in their blood glucose control. We also found that just the brief 4 sessions on motivation to being also did not lead to improvement. But when we added cognitive behavioral therapy to motivational interviewing, this led to clinically and statistically significant improvements in glycemic control. At this point, I'd like to just mention Angus Borse, who is professor of Penn Diabetes Nursing, who translated this study and its findings into the first nurse-led diabetes and psychology service at King's. And also to Nicole de Souza, took some of the concepts from the DAP study and has translated it into some really pioneering work around in type 2 diabetes and also in cardiovascular risk prevention. As these studies are in progress, I don't really have data for you to give you, but I thank Nicole for the huge amount of work she's put into developing some amazing manuals and interventions. We've also discovered, and it's Nicole discovered, that I'm translating these findings, that we weren't getting as many patients attending the sessions as we would like. This is because people with diabetes also have other lives, and they've already had to come to hospital for their diabetes appointments, and now we're asking them to come for 12 to 20 sessions of therapy. They had jobs, they had careers, they were at university, and had other roles, either looking after carers, elderly or children. So what we've developed is that we've taken our work from the face-to-face work and developed it into an e-health system. In collaboration with Psychology Online, we already have evidence-based intervention of providing online real-time CBT. We're integrating that with training diabetes nurses in eCBT. These are nurses who are already excellent at delivering the diabetes care. And we're also going to be adding an app which allows patients to record their thoughts and feelings around their diabetes self-monitoring. We've just received some funding from the Small Business Research Institute and also from the Health Foundation to road test this product. So that what we have is that we have patients talking to the computer, but that all of the information is being communicated back into the NHS systems. I'd like to thank David Hopkins, who is one of the diabetologists at King's College Hospital. Now, I don't know how many of you trained at the Maudsley in the 1990s and the early 20s, but if you did, you'll remember David Hopkins as the only doctor wearing a white coat that would be willing to cross the road from King's College Hospital to Maudsley to see our patients. He's been a real inspiration for me, and he has led the integration of psychological care at a service level at King's. And it was his idea that developing the DOC project, the integrated e-health system at King's as a virtual centre, so that patients don't have to travel long distances, they could stay out where they're coming from, Maidstone, and have their care staying at Maidstone, but they have this virtual clinic with King's. I'd also like to thank Anne Doherty, who's only been a consultant psychiatrist for 2 years to work with me. And in that time, she has expanded the service and taken it as her own, and has also, as a CBT therapist, is leading the DOC project. I'd like to move on to the third part of my talk, which is the translation into clinical practice. The work that we do has little relevance if the end receivers, the people with the diabetes, either do not support it or do not benefit from it. And I have worked with many people with diabetes as patients, experts, or as peers. And there are two people that particularly stand out. Richard Lane, who is Chief Executive of Diabetes UK, and Sheila Burston, who used to run the Bexley Diabetes User Group. I have no idea how she used to persuade me to come all the way in the cold winter nights out into the States to talk to a diabetes user group, but I used to love it. So what did we do with our translation model? We had high levels of psychiatric morbidity in our clinic, but also in inner city London, there's high levels of social deprivation. And what we were observing is that people were not able to look after their diabetes if A, they've got psychological problems, and B, social problems. So Carol Gale and I developed an intervention called Three Dimensions of Care for Diabetes. And in this, the key innovations are A, that we include the patient in the management and got the patient to set the goals. But we brought in community caseworkers who addressed the social problems, and at the same time integrating the psychological care with the diabetes care, all in one team and across all the sectors of healthcare, from primary, community to secondary. Now, Carol Gale has been my co-worker on 3D project for many years, and each time she keeps telling me that how many hoops and loops that we have to jump to get it going. Carol, I'm just a simple academic that likes to see patients, but Carol is one of those who likes to get things done. She also has another bringing up impact, tariffs, cost-cutting, unscheduled care, tendering. And I'd also like to thank Tim Smart, who's the Chief Executive of King's College Hospital, who actually has always been one very supportive of all our work. And I think it takes a brave Chief Executive to support a psychiatrist within the Kew Trust. This is an example of the work that we've been doing. Here's a support worker, Debbie, from Thames Reach, which is a third sector organisation. And she's visiting this patient on the right-hand side with who has diabetes and poor control. Now, this patient is not going to look after her diabetes because the person upstairs, in living in the flat upstairs, suffers from schizophrenia. It's very noisy and leaves his taps running. And she gets very upset about this kind of noise and pollution. And so Debbie she also has literacy problems, so Debbie's helping her complete her complaints form and her housing application form. And as a result of which all this was done, the patient felt more confident about looking after her diabetes. And actually, when we looked at all of our patients, this intervention has led to massive improvements in blood glucose control, nearly 1.5% reduction in the HbA1c, which compares favourably with any of the new diabetes drugs that come into the market, which, you know, they're good if they get a 0.5% reduction in HbA1c. It's also led to receiving some awards. We've won 3 awards now. The first was the Quality and Care Awards in 2011. This year, we won the King's College Hospital, won the BMJ Awards for the Best Diabetes Team Award. And how about that for a psychiatrist winning a Papa Diabetes Team? And next year, we have been awarded the Mary McKinnon Named Lecture at the Diabetes UK Annual Professional Conference for the Fruity-Fording Project. And I'd like to really actually just talk about the future. When I first started in diabetes, I think I was a bit of a loner and everybody thought I was a bit mad. But actually what's happened is that there's an increasing number of young psychiatrists who are showing a new interest in medicine. Carol Kahn, who's got a Novo Nordisk fellowship, is in search of God, the genetics of depression and diabetes. Chris Garrett is a psychotherapist who single-handedly is developing a whole new psychological approach to thinking about type 1 diabetes. He's applying attachment theory to the relationship that people with type 1 diabetes have with their diabetes. Katie Ridge, who used to be a research worker with us, fell in love with the subject and went on to do medicine, keeps coming back and doing lots of studies with us. And Callum Moulton is an academic clinical fellow who is going to treat this inflammation in depression and diabetes. And finally, Kirsty Winkley, who isn't a doctor, is a nurse, has got her NIHR postdoc fellowship and is going to develop a whole new field of the psychology of insulin. There are many people that I have not had a chance to mention, partly because they're research that I did many moons ago, or research that is still in progress, and I've practiced them all here. And thank you so much to all of them. I also like to thank my family, my 2 children and my husband, Daniel and Zachary Warsaw. My children are glued to my forehead even when I go to work. And my husband, Andy, has been my emotional, moral and intellectual compass all of these years. Now, when you've got both parents working, one of the challenges is how to distract the children, and you have to find increasingly adventurous ways of keeping them busy. I won't show you what happened in the next slide, but a few bumps. So I'm going to end my talk as I started. And if you're a Trekkie, you know this is correct. The mind in diabetes, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Institute of Psychiatry Starship Enterprise. Until there is a cure for type 1 diabetes, and until we start eating less and exercising more, its continuing mission is to explore the mind in diabetes as a force for destruction and a force for good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. a nice picture of it, actually. Well done. It's a long time for that one, I'm sure. Now, inaugural lectures are very important in the life of a person, and indeed in the life of an institution, and it's important to think just a little bit about why that is, and where they came from. And they started a long time ago in the life of the medieval university. Back then, the university did not pay its professors at all. It merely provided a platform for them. The students paid, they had to pay their own fees, and the inaugural lecture was where the new professor would come and kind of put out his stall. It was always his stall in those days. If the students liked him, then they would hand over some coins, and indeed would continue to do that to be for the privilege of being taught. If they didn't, that was tough. You can imagine then what it was like then, a university that had no actual central funds to pay its staff, students who had to pay for their own tuition, and a system of payment by results. Well, Barrick, I think you'll agree. But of course, even in a completely alternative, tricky universe, that of course will never happen, we were to return to those terribly medieval days, the one thing you can say, even on the basis of your own inaugural, is that you are guaranteed untold riches, because that was a splendid and wonderful presentation. And indeed, listening to your story was great fun, because it did remind me of quite a lot of parallels that we have had, me and you. Strikes many chords. We trained at the same places. You didn't mention that you also did a house job at Northampton General. Do you remember that? You probably went there for the same reason that I did, because they used to give free beer to all junior doctors. Those great customs, and I'm sure as long as it's gone. And you came here in 1995, and you have stayed ever since. We met very shortly after that, as you said, and indeed, just as you said with Kirsty, the fact that you're still here persuades me that I must be doing at least something right, and I hope the Dean has noted that. Now, your work is generally amazing. I know that because Robert Lecter tells me that every time we bloody meet. He's incapable of giving any talk on the KHP and the benefits of integrating physical and mental health without reference to your work and the particular papers that you've shown. I'm told on very good authority that he actually uses your name in his sleep. Apparently it's caused some problems. Yes, I also said you were very modest and was about to inform the audience about the awards that you had won. Unfortunately, you did that for still, if you got it flaunted, why not? Right, I mean, you know, these awards, they mean absolutely nothing until, of course, you won a few. However, what you did say, very correctly and very honestly, is of course that these awards are not given to individuals, they're given to teams, and teams figured greatly in your talk in all the various shapes and forms. But of course, every team is not just a team, it also needs its Ronaldo, its Messi, or its Rooney. Well, actually, perhaps not. It's not quite a team. But that's very much the role that you also have. So, Khalida, then, you have been an amazing clinician, and still are. You're a great teacher, and still are, and you're a wonderful academic. And your work has already influenced us locally, nationally, and now internationally as well. But I think you're one thing more important than that, certainly to me. You're a wonderful colleague and a great friend. So, ladies and gentlemen, you'll join me, please. First of all, we'll congratulate Khalida, and after that, in the tradition of the medieval university, we will then go upstairs for roast swan and mead.